I'm Jim Anderton, and this is the Industry Insights and Trends podcast. On this show, we'll explore the length and breadth of 21st century engineering, from civil engineering megaprojects to innovation at the quantum level. We speak with subject matter experts and industry watchers from every sector of the engineering discipline. On this episode, what's the state of the art in additive manufacturing? I'm joined by Engineering.com senior editor Ian Wright, who describes the latest advances in the fast-moving field of industrial 3D printing.
I'm Ian, welcome to the podcast.
Thanks, Jim. Happy to be here.
The topic of today is additive manufacturing. I keep wanting to call it 3D printing. There's still, I think, some confusion sort of swirling around there. I think I tend to think of the hobbyists call it 3D printing and the experts call it additive manufacturing. You're deeply immersed in this subject, doing what you do at engineering.com. Let's kick off that way. Says, what is the nomenclature? Is there a difference between those two words?
I think it's partly down to personal preference. For me, I lean the way that you mentioned that. Additive manufacturing is the kind of industrialized, the professional version. Sometimes I think if you're speaking more generically, you might talk about 3D printing as the technology, and then how it gets implemented in various ways, will depend. But in general, I sort of see 3D printing as the more hobbyist, the more casual version. And then additive is when you're getting into, professional end-use parts, tooling, fixtures, that kind of thing. Then you'd call it additive manufacturing.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting technology because it is continually, or we're bombarded continually in the media about new applications and new uses for it. As recently as yesterday, I saw a press release from NASA, the International Space Station, how they're 3D printing human tissue in orbit, doing all kinds of fascinating things here. Yet it's been around a long time, hasn't it?
It's as old as I am. It is 40 years old. The very first patents were filed in 1984, I think. Chuck Hull, actually, founder of 3D Systems, he just got elected into the National Academy of Engineers for creating stereolithography back in the 80s and essentially kicking off the whole additive manufacturing industry.
Yeah. Now, in terms of there are multiple technologies at play here. I think that's not widely understood. I think that so many hobbyist units, which are basically look like glorified glue guns on a pantograph, extruding filament onto a bed. But there are a lot of different ways to skin this cat, aren't there?
Yeah. I think the official number at the moment is that there are seven technologies that are sort of within the standards that are recognized. And part of the trouble is that you can sort of carve up the beast in a number of different ways, right? So you could talk about it in terms of materials, right? Polymers versus metals versus ceramics in some cases. You can talk about it in terms of process. So contrasting, for example, photopolymerization and material extrusion. There's all the various sintering-based technologies. There's a lot to pick apart with it. And one of the complaints I hear most often is that we're in an industry that's sort of awash in acronyms and short forms, and it's just difficult to keep track of them all. I've got tables in front of me that have, the 10 different ways that you talk about powder bed fusion and all the various acronyms that go with it.
Yeah. Now, it's interesting to me that you've got some interesting technologies that seem to sort out by application. For a long time, for example, there's a thought that if you need, say, optical clarity in a part, you're going to be using a photolithography process. Mm-hmm. You're going to be using stinky chemicals in a tank, and it's going to be very expensive to make those parts, and it's great for prototypes, but, I'm going to end up injection molding at the end of the day anyway. Are those old rules still true?
Somewhat, yeah. I think is more a matter of volume these days. So if you need, 10,000, 100,000 parts, yeah, probably you're not going to be 3D printing them. But in terms of the actual material quality, those old photopolymers, they used to be pretty short-lived. They break down fairly quickly over time, even just sitting on your desk, right? They just sort of naturally degrade. But we've come a long way since then. We've got a lot more polymers on offer. If you go to an additive manufacturing show today, you'll see walls of all the different plastics and thermoplastics and everything that's available. So it's the materials have grown a lot over the last 40 years.
Yeah. And sticking with that materials theme, the original knock on this as a production process was, I'm very limited into the amount of materials, number of options that I have. Basic commodity resins, for example, typically, some specialty stuff. But now I understand that you basically can 3D print, can additively manufacture in the same tens of polymeric materials that you would make production parts in, true?
Yeah. You can do PEEK, you can do ULTEM. Those are the ones that have really taken off in the last while, especially in aerospace applications where you need those sort of the higher higher temperature plastics that can take the extreme swings in space-based applications, for example. But you see a lot of companies now are even getting into just taking the resin pellets from injection molding and feeding them into their system. Depends on the machine, obviously, but yeah.
I mean, for the high temperature applications, it used to be your options are peak, but yeah. There are more things out there now.
Yeah, for sure. And it's interesting too, because I think the technology itself is kind of enabling a lot of these interesting sort of metamaterial applications, right? You can get really into the weeds with this stuff now, especially with some of the up and coming technologies, like two photon polymerization that's mostly used for very small applications, tiny medical devices and that sort of thing. You get a lot of control over the materials when you get down to that level. And so you can do a lot of really interesting work with it.
Well, I'm glad you brought up the medical applications because I'm seeing a lot of activity in medical applications. Medical is a broad field, and within the same industry, you'll get individuals that might be making a rack that holds an IV bag onto a pole, another one that's making something that's a heart stent or replacement heart valve that's surgically implantable. Is that a natural way to bifurcate that market? Do we think there's in vivo, ex vivo? Is that one way to think about it?
I mean, I think that's one way that you could carve it up. Certainly, if we come back, I mean, it's a little strange to put it this way, but if you come back to materials again, there's sort of examples of like bioprinting, right? It's a whole emerging field where you're actually printing tissue or tissue scaffolds. That's sort of in a category of its own. It's not classified under one of those sort of seven major types of 3D printing that I mentioned before. But I think there's a couple of different ways that you could look at it. If we look at sort of around the time of the COVID pandemic, you had hospitals that were printing mask shields and things like that with extrusion-based technologies. If you're getting into the sort of the in vivo or in vitro medical spaces now, you're probably looking at, especially on the metal side of things, that's where there's a lot of growth. Things like hip and other joint replacements are very big. And then, getting into the sort of stents and catheters and that sort of area.
Yeah. In the major critique, I don't want to say criticism because it's really more of a critique that mainstream manufacturers have had about additive is surface finish. Mm-hmm. Is that basically, I need a consistent surface finish, a fine surface finish, maybe not a super finish, but perhaps a smooth finish, if not a polished finish. And I've got to post-process. Yeah. And there's some cost and time involved in post-processing it. How much, and from a cost perspective, is that post-processing side of this equation? Is that the dominant factor here?
I think less than it used to be, because certainly as the materials have improved, as the processes have gotten more refined, the finishes are better now, certainly than what they used to be. And there's also a lot more process control, right? So you can sort of pick the parts of the part that you want to make sure have the surface finish that you need and just post-process them. Others you can leave sort of rougher if you know they're not going to be sort of vital surfaces in that way. It's certainly post-processing is still, I think, if you talk to people in the industry, it's still sort of an underappreciated aspect of a lot of these applications.
Yeah. The injection molding community, degating the part was always a factor, basically, and there are a lot of tricks you have to use to try and conceal the gates, either in the design of the product or again, in a post-molding finishing part. In case of additive, I'm talking resins here, of course, is that you've got some support structures that are often in play here. And I've seen various sort of ways to cope with the support structures, either similar to the degating process of injection molding, or in some cases using a different material that you can actually dissolve out around a more resistant primary material. Is that the best way to go?
Yeah, it's sort of obviously depends on your application, but certainly in cases where you can afford to do a couple of materials in one, if you've got one that can be kind of sacrificial, then that makes the process a lot easier. There's also a lot that goes into the sort of design of the part now, right? And orientation is a very big deal when you're setting these things up. And if you can set the part up in a way that you don't need as many supports, right, that's just less work for you after the fact. And that holds true for a lot of different processes as well, whether you're talking about resins or if we're talking about metals as well. Anything you can do to kind of cut down on the number of supports that you need, it's going to save you on materials. It also makes build time faster. So, it's a very interesting aspect of the field.
Yeah. Now, especially for some high aspect ratio parts, sometimes the most efficient packing within the build envelope is not the same as the most efficient conformation for support of the part at the end. Mm-hmm. So is that sort of trade-off? I mean, what do you do in a situation where I know I could get eight parts instead of six if I could just stack them on their ends, but they'll warp.
Yeah, it's interesting to see. I mean, there's software now that will essentially do the stacking for you, right? So I know, I think Form Labs had a case study about this recently where they had an engineer working out of his home, and he's got, this big powder-based machine, and he was producing adapters for iPod headphones, essentially, he figured out how to pack as many as he could into the chamber, stacking them up. So I think he was making, 50, 60 parts at a time. Using that, he was able to essentially, he called it like a one-man plastics factory, right? He's working out of his home and he's producing like thousands of these things. Now, he had to have all the setup and everything himself. And obviously, there's a lot of material handling and everything that goes into it. But on the whole, I think a lot of this can be done through sort of smart use of software and the right sort of simulation tools.
Yeah. Now, it's in mass production, of course, there's an old adage of bigger is better. And basically, in things like machine tools, injection molding equipment, die casting, the theory is that, a bigger machine is more productive. Cycle time is lower because it's larger and there are more moving parts, but it is nonetheless, on a per part per hour basis, the most efficient way to do it. Is that true of additive? Is the biggest machine possible the solution, or are you better off with, say, a bank of smaller machines?
I think it depends on where you're sort of looking at, which industry you're focusing on. Because certainly in the medical space, you're probably better having a number of smaller machines, especially when you're getting into those kind of microscopic submillimeter type applications. If we're talking about things like aerospace part production, I think certainly the bigger volume is just generally better because it gives you more flexibility in the kinds of parts you can make. Now, in a lot of cases, you can break down the parts. Theoretically, you could have something that would be printed in pieces and then, welded or adhered together. But, one of the big values of additive is still in this kind of part consolidation space, right? So the more you can do in a sort of single build, the better off you are. And so, I think in the larger applications, probably volume is still key.
Yeah. You mentioned part consolidation, and there was a time when companies that wanted to invest in this technology were trapped into a specific corporate ecosystem. So you bought the machine from a vendor and you bought everything. You bought all supporting chemistry from them. You bought the raw materials from them, and you had to. You relied on them for tech support to help you along the way to develop your part. We're seeing an increasing aftermarket third-party material suppliers popping up, some specialty material suppliers popping up, sort of a separate pool of expertise. Is that the future? Are we going to go to something that we have, for example, in the machine tool world, where machine tools, cutting tools, and machine tools, work holding, are all sold by separate companies, and they all work together?
It's an interesting question, because I think we've seen, especially kind of in the last year or so, there's been a lot of waxing and waning of these suppliers, right? So you've had a number of major material suppliers like BASF spun out a separate business to deal specifically with additive. And then I think sort of around the end of last year, the start of this year, they went insolvent. So it's difficult to say where exactly this is going to end up. I mean, I think it makes sense for these things to become a lot more commoditized just as the industry grows. But obviously, from the machine supplier's perspective, they'd rather keep you, locked into an ecosystem if they can. So it's a trade-off, I think, right? Because if your competitors are offering machines that can work with a number of different materials, then they've got an inherent advantage over you if you're sort of restricted to just what you offer on hand.
Yeah. Now, of course, for years, this was a prototyping technology. You'd find the unit, for example, in the engineering office or the design office, where they're we're making functional prototypes out of this. Then came a generation of production machines rather than prototyping machines. What happens in that gray area between those two areas for, say, the job shop or the individual that needs 100 parts, but not 1,000 parts at that point? Is the tendency there to use R&D type machines for production, or to go and do your research on a production machine?
So I think that's where you get some interesting cases with companies like Desktop Metal, right? Where they've got machines that can produce metal parts to fairly high, I think they can get 99% density on their parts. But this is a machine that you could have in an office, right? They're set up so that they can handle the material. They keep everything contained. And you can do those sort of runs of sort of, 100 parts at a time, maybe, if you need them.
Yeah. So it's I guess the question we're asking is that are we seeing the world that was predicted, which is this will start to replace machining injection molding, thermoforming, and actually see a real impact where we're just going to see a reduction sort of in interest in those other technologies. Is that the future for this?
I don't think so. I think additive certainly has its place, and I think that's one thing that the industry's kind of learned as it's matured is that there was a lot of hype and sort of optimism in the early days of thinking that one day you just have, you know, factories filled with 3D printers and nothing else. I don't think we're ever going to get quite to that point because there are just certain cases where it's just not, it doesn't make economic sense, right, to throw out your injection molding machine or your CNC for, you know, the latest 3D printers. So I think it's more sort of a combination of technologies. Really, it comes down to using the 3D printers where they play to their strengths, right? If you're doing, as you mentioned, sort of lower volume parts, or if you need something where the geometry is just too complex to machine or to mold, it's finding the right sort of niche applications. And when you get into those cases, I think there's no competition for it, right? But things like investment casting, right? It's often forgotten about, but there's a lot of work you can do with 3D printed investment casting and in investment casting applications. And that's a case where I think, you know, you're not going to get rid of the casting process entirely, obviously, but you can augment it essentially using 3D printing.
Wow, so much to talk about. I'm sure we're going to talk more about this in the future. Ian Wright, Senior Editor, Engineering.com. Thanks for joining me on the podcast.
Happy to be here.
That's it for today's Industry Insights and Trends podcast, brought to you by Engineering.com. If you like this program and want to keep pace with the latest innovations in engineering, subscribe to our newsletters, such as Design Weekly, 3D Printing, Aerospace and Defense, Digital Transformation, Simulation, or a weekly roundup at engineering.com/subscribe. For our deeper engineering series, visit engineering.com TV for exclusive shows like Designing the Future, Manufacturing the Future, and the Engineering Roundtable, found exclusively on engineering.com TV. Thanks for tuning in.